distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen, good evening. It gives me great pleasure to extend to you all a very warm welcome on behalf of the Finance Department and the Faculty of Arts for our very first lecture, which is going to kick off our behind-the-scenes series. Over the last years, Hong Kong's art world has grown with increasingly more and more different types of institutions. We are seeing more and more artists, curators, and visitors coming to Hong Kong giving talks. But the growth of this community has also raised questions regarding how we look after our own art. Behind the Scenes offers, for the first time, dedicated lectures aimed for our students and the general public to increase awareness of the different type of new technologies and old skills used in the field. They will also be discussing some of the ethics and best practices that are necessary and that underlines the importance of looking after our past and our present. The aim of these talks is to highlight the kind of work that takes place behind the scenes by our unsung heroes, whose work often goes unnoticed, but who has helped to sustain and maintain a healthy art world for future audience. Of course, none of this is possible without a lot of help, and we have great help from Qatar Airways, our airline sponsor, and AXO Art, our event sponsor. So thank you very much. I also want to draw your attention to the second of our talks. Mary Louise Salberg, who will be talking about Westminster Abbey and the Coronation Throne this coming Friday, 6:30 at Asia Society, who has also kindly offered venue support. Please do join us. I've actually taken a sneak peek at her PowerPoint and there's lots and lots of fun images in there. Before I hand over the stage to our Dean, Professor Derek Collins, who will introduce our speaker tonight, I'm in charge of some housekeeping, and they're very basic, simple rules. Can you make sure you switch off your phones or turn it to silence? And if you are planning to take any pictures, can you make sure you do not use a flash? Thank you very much.
Well, thank you, Yuan, and welcome everyone. And I'm delighted to have the opportunity this evening to be with you briefly and to introduce our speaker for the evening, who is, well, as you know, Larry Keith. He is the Director of Collections, Interim, at the National Gallery, Head of Conservation and Keeper, where he's been working since 1991, first as a paintings conservator and then becoming Head of Conservation in 2010. He studied paintings and conservation at the Hamilton Care Institute, University of Cambridge, and has worked as a painting conservator in the United States and Britain. He has contributed numerous articles on painting techniques across the range of the collection for the gallery's publication, Technical Bulletin, as well as made contributions to exhibition catalogues on Diego Velazquez and Leonardo da Vinci. His many high-profile achievements include the following. Leonardo da Vinci's The Virgin of the Rocks, which was an 18-month restoration project that you might say liberated the original from its cracked and yellow-varnished prison. His work on one of the most famous portraits in all of art history, Pope Innocent X, a painting once owned by no less than Catherine the Great of Russia, and which has also been called a ferociously ugly depiction, confirmed, his work on that actually confirmed that it was indeed by Diego Velazquez. And famously, his discovery of a Rembrandt painting beneath another Rembrandt using X-ray technology, which exemplifies in some ways the frontier in art history in which science meets the humanities to reveal a deeper and more fully fledged past. We're delighted to have Larry with us today, not only because of the expertise and unique insights he will share from his vantage point at the National Gallery, but also because his presence here bespeaks an aspiration of the Faculty of Arts and the Department of Fine Arts at the University of Hong Kong. This was touched on by Dr. Kuhn. Together at HKU, we're working to increase the educational opportunities we provide to students, the public, and working professionals in art history, cultural heritage, and conservation studies. It's our goal to make the Department of Fine Arts the leading site of research and the preferred provider of education in art history and its corresponding objects-based disciplines, and to be recognized such as such throughout Asia. As part of that mission, and as the inaugural speaker of our behind-the-scenes lecture series, we aim regularly to bring to you the very best experts from the international world to Hong Kong. So with that, I'd like to thank Larry for joining us, and I'd like to welcome him on stage and welcome him to HKU. Thank you very much.
thank you, Dean, faculty, and sponsors for this evening's lecture. It's a real honor and privilege to be here. I'll just wait for the screen to come down, the lights to go. And there we are. And so I want to talk to you about conservation at the National Gallery. I think the department in the National Gallery was established in an official way just after the war. But I think if you want to understand its present structure and function, we also need to look at the longer history of restoration within the museum from the time of the gallery's foundation in 1824. Doing this inevitably will touch on some sensitive matters regarding the aesthetics of conservation. And these disputes are fascinating evidence of the evolving relationship between curatorial, conservation, and scientific roles. These debates have done a great deal to influence the development of my profession and the definition of its role within the museum today. And so I'd like to summarize them briefly. In a sense, restoration could be said to have been at the very center of the gallery's foundation in 1824. Its first keeper, William Sager, was an established dealer and restorer. He'd worked extensively for Sir George Beaumont, who was the Earl of Grosvenor, and his collection would subsequently provide one of the initial founding bequests of the National Gallery. Sager also worked for other important collectors before he assumed his duties at the gallery, including the Duke of Wellington, as early as 1814, when he was asked to give advice on the paintings he got from the Spanish Royal Collection that he captured from Joseph Bonaparte the previous year, and that includes the Velazquez to which Dean had referred. Sager was probably the last person to restore this study for Innocent X, which remains in Apsley House. And you see an image before its recent restoration. At the National Gallery, William Sager's duties were listed as, quote, to have charge of the collection, to attend the care and preservation of the pictures, and to superintend the arrangements for admission, to be present occasionally in the gallery, and to value and negotiate the purchase of any pictures that may in future be added to the collection. And this is a good one. And to perform such other services as may be from time to time called upon to do by instruction from the board. That could be a lot. It was reported by the Times in 1853 that during his keepership there was no record of any picture having been cleaned, an approach which would have met with the approval of his former patron, Sir George Beaumont, who famously stated that, quote, a good painting, like a good violin, should be brown. As a result, the collection was routinely treated by Sager and his brother John, another leading restorer, by coating the paintings with the so-called gallery varnish. Now, this was a solution of mastic resin in boiled linseed oil, and periodically he'd oil them out with linseed oil as well as the varnishes became dull or dried. It's quite likely that by the time Charles Eastlake succeeded Sager in 1843, most or all of the pictures in the collection had got this deep toning buildup that had been advocated by Beaumont. Now, Eastlake was himself a painter, in addition, a pioneering scholar of historic painting methods, and he therefore took a very different view of the treatment of the collection. Between 1843 and 47, he had a number of pictures cleaned and restored by John Sager and another restorer, Thomas Bowden Brown. And it seems clear that this work must have entailed the elimination or a significant reduction of this buildup, this accumulation of toned restorers' varnishes. Now here's an image of the so-called Duguay, it's a sort of studio painting, the landscape with the storm, and it shows a rare surviving example of the practice of toned varnishes. You can see the accumulated layers of oil and mastic combined with notorious atmospheric pollution of 19th century London have given us a very, very brown surface. Although there are no plans to clean this picture, you can see a few details of small cleaning tests, you know, showing the blue of the sky and the light landscape, and they give you an excellent idea of the shock cleaning pictures to this degree must have caused. And while these tests give you an idea, happily enough, we have another painting with a similar level of discoloration. Pardon me. And there are not many left, and it was recently fully treated, and so we can more or less give you a replica of the authentic 1850s experience of seeing such a cleaning. This is a Florentine Adoration of the Shepherds from around 1600. And it hadn't been cleaned since the mid to late 19th century, and as a result, its surface had discolored a great deal, at least as much as we've seen on the Duguay. You can see the incredible change in these images. And here it is after. Just to give you a sense. So, before and after. Now, the thing is, during the 1840s, works which were treated in this way and probably had a similar kind of transformation were paintings that we all know and love now, like Rubens' Brazen Serpent, the Titian studio Venus and Adonis, and Peace and War by Rubens, all of which were sent for treatment by Eastlake. And so, as a sort of thought experiment, the works that he had cleaned were cleaned annually during the six-week summer period when the gallery was closed. But their return each autumn, you know, they'd be placed amongst these deep brown tones of the other pictures within the collection, and it provoked a major and prolonged controversy about this approach. I mean, imagine a wall combining these kinds of paintings. Eastlake resigned as keeper in 1847, ironically over a completely different controversy concerning attribution of a painting he bought. But the cleaning policy continued well into the 1850s, when other works such as Claude's Embarkation or this landscape with the Marriage of Isaac and Rebecca, of a Veronese, and Rubens' St. Babbo, and of course, one of the most popular paintings today in the gallery, the Stonemason's Yard, were all cleaned during this period by Sager and Brown. And so the debate was very heated and was carried out mostly through letters to the Times. And a sense of the nature of the discussion can be seen in exchange over this picture, The Judgment of Paris, which was cleaned by Thomas Bowden Brown and retouched by Charles Eastlake himself after its purchase in 1844. So here we have a letter against to the Times. The picture was acquired last year, cleaned before it was hung in the gallery. Those who've seen it in the auction room when it was purchased were sensible of the judicious manner to which its beauties were brought to light before it was exhibited to the public. The picture was painted on panel and depends much on glazing for its effects. Excuse me, if I said that was against, that's actually as good as it gets. That's very much in favor. Now, the opposing view, a man called J. Morris Moore, who signed his letters as Varax, during the vacation, The Judgment of Paris was considerably injured, he said. Its vigor and vivacity having been reduced to smooth and monotonous insipidity by the scouring, which has the effect of enervating those last masterly touches which gave point and reality to the whole. So you can see two very different assumptions about how paintings should look. And so by 1853, the controversy had built to the point where the House of Commons appointed a select committee to inquire into the constitution and administration of the gallery. And there was a brief moratorium on cleaning for about a year or so. The committee completed its investigation and submitted to the House of Commons a report of over 1,000 pages, including evidence extracted from artists, restorers, critics, dealers, connoisseurs. The committee noted the widely conflicting nature of opinion on procedures and the results of cleaning. It condemned, however, the use of that dark brown toned gallery varnish and recommended numerous administrative changes at the gallery, suggesting a number of formalities with regard to cleaning pictures, including preparing reports and of completed restoration work. And as a result of the committee's report, Eastlake, who'd since become president of the Royal Academy, was returned and elevated in 1855 to the new position of director of the National Gallery, where he stayed until he died in 1865. His directorship was marked by the rapid expansion of the collection. He was responsible for the acquisition of 139 paintings. And as a result, he had close contact with dealers and restorers who were active in the art market, both in London and abroad, especially Milan, where he formed a close working relationship with Giuseppe Molteni for the restoration of works which he acquired in Italy. I think I've jumped a slide. There we are. Here's an example of something he purchased and Molteni restored. And it's interesting to speculate about Eastlake's motives in having so many of his Italian purchases restored there before they came to England. There's no doubt it was primarily about his respect for the skills of the Milanese restorers, but it would also have been quite useful to present the paintings in London with their restorations as fait accompli, leaving the public no opportunity to consider the changes brought by these transformations. Very crafty. By the standards of his day, Eastlake was very much a savvy connoisseur of restorations, given his interest in painting himself, and he was very sensitive to issues of condition and the marketplace. And he said, quote, when a picture is bought at auction, the first thing the happy possessor does is put it into the hands of a picture cleaner to put it in order, as it's called. And although that picture may be sold 20 times over in the course of a very short time, the same operation is always repeated. Now, in London, Eastlake and subsequent directors continued using a variety of private restorers, usually with a background in fine arts and ordinarily having no formal chemistry background or training. And that's an interesting point that the Select Committee raised in 1853. They wondered whether the gallery ought to have dedicated professional scientific expertise in conservation. And Michael Faraday was one of the people brought to the committee and asked, quote, do you not think if you were employed professionally or officially to make certain experiments with reference to the preservation of pictures by means of varnishes or other things, very beneficial results might not accrue from such experiments? And he answered, I haven't the smallest doubt that a person of competent chemical knowledge and a little acquainted also with the practice of painting in ancient and modern times might be valuably employed in ascertaining such points. And I wonder that it should be left, as it were, to accident when accurate knowledge upon the subject might be so easily acquired. Crafty Eastlake, however, considered that chemists should be consulted and, if necessary, paid, but it would, quote, complicate the machinery very much, end quote, if the government decided, as the committee suggested, to appoint chemists to consider how solvents and chemical applications act upon pictures. And so, through the late 19th century and early 20th, the system of sending gallery pictures out to private restorers was maintained, with no dedicated in-house attention to what we would consider today preventive conservation. The practice of restoration remained essentially reactive, responding to blistering paint or foggy varnishes or discoloration. By the 1930s, however, the situation was changing. When the first dedicated conservation laboratory was organized as early as 1888, in the Staedtlicher Museum in Berlin, the 1930s also saw the establishment of restoration departments, laboratories, and training programs in the Fogg Museum in Harvard, the Metropolitan Museum, the Akademie der Bildenden Kunst in Vienna, the Louvre, Courtauld, and Derner Institutes. In Britain, there was also a notable influx of art historians and restorers who'd come to the country fleeing National Socialism, including people such as Ernst Gombrich, Johannes Hell, and for our purposes, most importantly, Helmut Ruhmann. Now, he was the key figure in the foundation of the conservation department. By 1934, he was being used to restore gallery pictures by Kenneth Clark, who'd become the gallery's director the previous year. Ruhmann had established a reputation as one of the leading picture restorers of his generation. Born in Berlin, he studied painting at Karlsruhe, Munich, Paris, and Madrid. And by 1929, he'd been the chief restorer at the Kaiser Friedrich Museum in Berlin. There, he promoted the use of X-rays as an analytical tool and favored complete removal of old varnish in cleaning pictures, in contrast to the more conservative approach of some of his contemporaries. His approach found tremendous favor with Kenneth Clark, who gave him several important pictures in the pre-war years, including such works as Velazquez's Philip IV in Brown and Silver, the 1936 restoration of which was another source of controversy. Subsequently, the National Gallery's next director, a man called Philip Hendy, was, if anything, more positive about Ruhmann's work, describing him, quote, as a new kind of restorer, for he had no secrets, and he had instead a longing to share his knowledge. Now, in the same year that Ruhmann's association with Clark began, 1934, the gallery also appointed a salaried scientific advisor, F.I.G. Rawlins. I'm afraid I don't know what it stands for, but in the gallery he's known as Figgy. Figgy Rawlins, an act which finally fulfilled Faraday's recommendations nearly 80 years earlier. While the scientific department is technically outside of conservation, the two areas, of course, have considerably overlapping interests and a very close working relationship. particularly where the preservation of the collection is concerned. In the years before the war, Rollins was a keen but unsuccessful advocate for introducing air conditioning within the galleries. Events during the war provided powerful proof of the importance of a regulated environment. The collection was evacuated eventually to a slate quarry in North Wales, where controlled central heating reduced the almost 100% relative humidity within the mines to a sustained and absolutely constant 58%, with a dramatic reduction in the need for consolidation and structural repair. Writing after the war, Philip Hendry stated that at Manad, the quarry where they were kept, at Manad, the calculations of the National Gallery Scientific Department proved correct from the first. The ministry's conditioning plant provided the climate to which the pictures had lived more comfortably than they'd ever lived before. Many of them have not, in consequence, enjoyed the return to the drafty and variable climate of the buildings in Trafalgar Square. It is extraordinary to realize that such terrible times in the gallery history laid a very important groundwork for the firm establishment of principles of environmental regulation and also provided the positive experience of the benefit of curators, restorers, and scientists working more closely together than they'd ever done before. The splendid isolation that Manad, as you can see from this, it still is completely in the middle of nowhere, gave an unlikely setting for advances in curatorial research, but it provided Martin Davies with a sustained and uninterrupted access to the pictures that allowed him to prepare his noteworthy collection catalogues. Here he is in his eccentric tea cozy hat, and Wellington's on the right. These impressive works of scholarship were newly informed by close study of the physical objects themselves. And it's not unreasonable to think this was influenced, to some degree, by the experience of working so closely with the restorers who happened to be there. A restoration studio was constructed just outside the entrance to the cave, of which only the foundation remains, which you can see on the right. But during the war, several pictures were cleaned and restored by a variety of restorers. As I think I said, Hendy succeeded Kenneth Clark as director in 1946, and in that same year saw the formal establishment of a conservation department and the creation of a scientific advisory committee within the gallery. He also supervised the reinstallation of the collection within the damaged building, where the return of several paintings which had been restored at Manad was as surprising to the public as the experience of Sager's restorations had been nearly a century previously. So here we go again. The look of the newly restored pictures with their cooler, more vibrant colors provoked another public debate like the 1850s, again, largely held within the pages of the letters column of the Times newspaper. Rembrandt's Woman Bathing can serve an example. Panel was cleaned in 1946 by Ruhrmann, and the treatment involved removing overpainting attributed to a 19th century restorer, which covered the subject's proper right hand. The retouching there and elsewhere on the painting was previously established and documented by X-ray, ultraviolet, and microscopic examination. As you can see, you've probably read it already, but comments ranged included things like this: the picture's been completely ruined, accents have vanished, ruthless action not justified, etc. However, in favor, far from being spoiled or damaged, the picture has become a revelation of beauty. The overpainted hand and wrist, which had been removed, were heavy and uncertain, not at all in keeping with the mind of Rembrandt. And you can see the black and white image shows that a 19th century restoration, proven, for example, by it sitting over a varnish layer. And you can see it's very much in keeping with an academic idea of everything needing to be perfectly finished and not really appreciating the way a painter like Rembrandt would manipulate his finish and show things rough and smooth as part of a demonstration of his talent. Anyway, this is the kind of controversy that motivated Hendy to mount his landmark exhibition of clean pictures in 1947. The famous Hogarth image of Time smoking a picture on the cover, in which 75 paintings cleaned between 1936 and 47 were displayed, together with supporting records, photographs, color prints, and explanatory diagrams, including photographs of the cutting-edge scientific apparatus employed in examination and analysis. partially clean paintings were included in the exhibition, which is extraordinary, together with material to demonstrate methods that were followed in the examination and recording the process, which had been so criticized. And there's no denying that highlighting these restorations through an exhibition was bold, I mean, provocative gesture, which intensified the debate of a restoration practice. So the points of the controversy provoked by this exhibition were referred to that scientific advisory committee I mentioned by the gallery's trustees. And so here we have another committee, the Weaver Committee, set up in 1947. The committee broadly endorsed the methods and results of the restorations. But the more important consequences of the Weaver Report were the recommendations to expand the gallery's conservation department and also its scientific department into structures that are recognizable, and they still closely resemble the present organization and staffing. The intent of doing so was, quote, to deal with arrears of cleaning and general conservation, which have accumulated over a span of years owing to the impossibility of keeping up with the rate of deterioration. This, again, in a period without a stable environmental control. I mean, this reorganization has been fundamentally important for the work of both departments in subsequent decades. It established the key principle of objective scientific research and support to inform decision-making by both restorers and curators about choices made during the restoration process, and also gave impetus over larger issues of environmental conditions, lighting, packing, transport, all those things we routinely consider now. Since the 1940s, the nature of the role of the conservator has broadened, you know, well beyond simply executing restorations. It includes a wider responsibility for the physical care of the collection in its broadest sense. This need is described in the 1992 Museums and Galleries Act, and has been further elaborated within galleries' recently described strategic aims. And so most of our work now takes place outside the realm of active treatments, but instead consists of a continuous process of invigilation, monitoring, application of best practice procedures and processes, mostly concerned with the care of the collection. And this includes preventive conservation. This includes, you know, monitoring environmental controls. Here's a graph of light and temperature in one of the galleries, pest monitoring, packing and transport, protocols for salvage and disaster conservation response, which we hope we never use, and routine inspection. In practice, preventive conservation draws upon expertise from across the museum, primarily conservation, scientific, and building departments, but it's done through the recently formed Preventive Conservation Working Group, which is led by a gallery conservator. It meets regularly to ensure communication across all these departments concerning anything to do with implications for preventive conservation, vibration from building programs, maintenance, new research, technologies, pest management, planning. We think about everything from salt being tracked in from people during heavy snows and what that means for the atmospheric salt and pigments, to monitoring and controlling cycles of moth infestation on fabrics, or even helping work out the appropriate noise levels for parties when we have amplified music in a near gallery space, among many other activities. So we carry out a continuous inspection of all our works twice a year, six times a year for the panels. As I said, we're very involved in issues of transport and display, starting with my decision when we have a loan request as to whether a picture is actually suitable to travel to the given venue. Then we think about conservation-based display needs and whether a loan might require particular courier expertise, like a stout heart when you see your painting going up by crane. I also have managerial responsibility for departments most concerned with other aspects of physical care and display. So again, it's broadening that idea of what taking care of paintings means. So here, this is art handling, the collection registrars, and framing. I'm also involved chairing incident management committee, which is again about thinking about protocols for salvage and disaster. Perhaps more interestingly, I think, I'm afraid, we have a significant involvement in galleries' research activity. And this is something that's done largely working together with curatorial and scientific colleagues. The collaboration with scientists began with research primarily into questions about materials and layer structures, almost exclusively related to performing a conservation treatment. You know, is this pigment anachronistic for, can we demonstrate its retouching from a layer structure, those sorts of questions. And that's quite a narrow remit, but it's expanded over decades to include a much more important and integral program of independent study of the history of painting technique and materials. And I think you get the best sense of that through looking at the National Gallery Technical Bulletin. It's a publication which just published its 37th issue. It's now freely available online through our website, so I urge you all to have a look. Quiz tomorrow. Written for the most part by gallery scientists, curators, and conservators, the bulletin covers all sorts of topics, including science of materials, environmental questions, treatments, techniques, the history of painting technique, and I think it's fair to say it's been a very respected and influential publication amongst our peers. That collaborative approach, which you see in the bulletin, was developed more in the 80s and 90s through our Art in the Making exhibitions. The first of these was dedicated to the study of Trecento painting technique, while we've also had exhibitions about Rembrandt, the Impressionists, and the use of the study of underdrawing as revealed through infrared reflectography. Here's some information from Rembrandt and underdrawing. The treatment of Holbein's Ambassadors is perhaps the best known example of an important restoration of major work being properly contextualized by coordinated scientific and art historical research. And the results of that appeared in another series of exhibitions dedicated to painting technique, making and meaning. And the series includes studies of the Wilton Diptych, Turner, the young Michelangelo. Other areas of current investigation are more concerned with best practice in conservation. One such topic is microclimates. Here you see a Perugino, now on long-term loan to the V&A, being sealed within its frame, as is often done. We have glass on the front and then attached as a sort of bag that goes around behind to make a microclimate. But this time, we fitted the inside of that environment with a sensor to allow us to monitor its performance. And so the bright green line is the shift in relative humidity within the space, and the darker olive green line is what's going on inside the microclimate. So you can see it's got a powerful mitigating effect and can really give much more confidence about certain kinds of pictures being acceptable to loan safely to certain venues. So it makes a really huge contribution, I think, to refining best practice for loan, transport, and display. So I think we can see that 1940s model of conservation working within the museum in close collaboration with curators and scientists has proved to be successful. It's also been flexible enough to accommodate big shifts in thinking about the aesthetics of restoration, which have happened since Ruhrmann's time. I think, personally, one of the most unfortunate consequences of that 1948 Clean Pictures exhibition has been the persistent false notion that conservation science acts as an enabler of a radical cleaning agenda. In fact, the pattern of close collaboration between scientist and restorer doesn't dictate a radical approach to restoration at all. It underscores the need to be as informed as possible about materials and structures of old master paintings. And that's not reduced by a greater acknowledgement, as we have today, of the subjective element in all painting restoration. I think it allows more nuanced judgments. And so here's a restoration of a polyptych by Niccolò Pietrogiardini. It gives you an example of how that kind of research and collaboration can serve such a nuanced goal. Cleaning went ahead in a manner that allowed us to distinguish between at least two varnish layers and layers of surface dirt. You can see them laid out here, which allowed the restorer to remove individual layers, one from another, in a controlled manner that served both the aesthetic aims of the treatment and, for example, respecting the extreme physical fragility of the vermilion pigments. And that itself, that fragility of vermilion, is a condition that's better understood through research done previously by the gallery's scientific department. And so we've left a discrete layer of varnish on the paint surface in selected areas in a controlled manner. Sometimes scientific research from my colleagues has confirmed our initial suspicions that the best thing to do is absolutely nothing. I like those treatments. Cross-section and medium analysis of Daubigny's cattle, a landscape with cattle by a stream, confirmed initial suspicion that Daubigny reworked his painting with a campaign of glazes and scumbles in a highly resinous medium, media which we couldn't really distinguish in solubility from the Damar varnish applied later. Contemporary sources indicated he often finished his outdoors plein air painting in the studio, but little was known about the materials he used. And very interestingly, the painting, The View on the Oise, which you see above, it gives a rather sad comparison. It's a bit hard to see here, but both paintings entered the gallery from the same collection at the same time, but the other upper picture was cleaned privately before it entered the collection. Now, I can't guarantee that it had glazes, like our landscape with cattle by a stream, but I can tell you that now it doesn't. And it appears that it's lost, you know, any campaign of resinous reworking that we can find on our own painting. More recently, combined investigation of Reynolds' Lord Heathfield in the conservation studio, together with very in-depth scientific analyses taken by my colleagues in that department, showed his extensive use of McGilp and other resinous glazes, which, you know, again, informed decisions about the treatment, or again, the lack of treatment. As it was determined, the composition of his paint meant it was best to do nothing. The new analytical technologies, however, that we used on this picture, and the experience collectively about looking and thinking about Reynolds, became the starting point for the gallery's later collaboration with the Wallace Collection in their landmark Reynolds Research Project. This was a four-year project sponsored by the Paul Mellon Center for Studies in British Art, in which Alexandra Gent, who was employed by the Wallace Collection but located in the gallery, worked together with National Gallery scientists to study 12 works by Reynolds, four of which were cleaned. The results of this work were communicated to the public through an exhibition held at the Wallace Collection, as well within the gallery's technical bulletin and an exhibition catalog. There's a dedicated bulletin issue only on Reynolds a couple of years ago. Now, going back to, you know, what goes on in the studio and actually working on paintings, I'm often asked, you know, what will be in the studio 6 or 12 months hence, and I really can't be as sure as you might like to hear. The selection and prioritization of paintings for treatment within the collection always has this degree of fluidity because it's based on so many factors, such as the physical preservation, aesthetic concerns, academic reappraisal, exhibition planning, and acquisition needs. The length of time for a treatment is often also very difficult to predict with much precision until you've actually started off. So short or medium term future planning of pictures is more of a continual process of reassessment than making a fixed schedule. I mean, of course, any remedial repair that we might discover in our inspections is dealt with immediately, a sort of triage. But most other treatments you will see have an elective element as well as, or rather than, a preservation need. Treatments are proposed to me, by me, to the director as suitable for bringing to the board that approves all of our treatments. And this comes from ongoing discussion with curatorial colleagues about preservation needs and aesthetic needs. But we also think about ongoing research and exhibition planning across the whole of the gallery. And so whenever we can, the major treatments will try to combine as many of these elements as possible. And here we're on to the Virgin of the Rocks, which we did between 2008 and 2010. And I think it gives a good example of how this project sits inside a whole kind of hub of activity. So the decision to undertake the restoration came from a consensus between curators and conservators. And that was in turn informed to a degree by many years of earlier restoration and collaborative research about many, many Milanese paintings we had within the collection. The determination to do the cleaning was driven by aesthetic considerations. The varnish, which was applied in the previous restoration from the 1940s, was really quite unstable. It had a mastic resin in turpentine with a lot of linseed oil added. And on top of that, there was a wax varnish applied later. So the varnish had yellowed, although not disastrously so, but I think the big problem was the fact that the cracking in the varnish and the atmospheric dirt which got stuck in the wax had really made it very difficult for the varnish to saturate the picture. And that means that the viewer really couldn't understand the handling and the tonal range from light to dark. And I think that's, I think we can agree that's the most distinctive quality of Leonardo's painting, certainly in this time. Now, the cleaning began in 2008, and I'm going to show you a sequence of slides, but I'd like you just to think about the fact that we didn't get huge shifts in color, as I showed you earlier, but a much improved saturation of the darker tones. So let's see. If I start here, you'll see the upper right has been cleaned, and it can move in a kind of counterclockwise circle. So there, the upper left. I move down, you see the difference, say, in the Virgin's head, yellow and less yellow, and then moving down through the Baptist and the lower left, and then across through the whole picture where there's quite a lot of damage in the angel. I could run back through it again just to get your eye in. So from upper right, left, down, and I think you can see what I mean there. I think especially in the darker tones underneath the Baptist, how foggy it is to the right of that and how much darker it is below. I mean, those are the key kind of gains. So this, as I said, will give you a much clearer idea of the modeling, the volume, and his intended spatial relationships. And so we wanted to get this from the cleaning through the reduction of the varnish, not just by taking it off, but by reducing it until it became as we wished it to. So if I show you an ultraviolet picture during cleaning, so the lower right, the old varnishes fluoresce in this kind of opaque, milky green color. And you can see where I've cleaned, there's still quite a thin, very, very thin layer, slightly variable. So we haven't, it's not a sort of hygienic removal of these varnishes, but quite a substantial amount has been taken away if you can compare the clean and unclean bits. And so here it is after cleaning and then after treatment. Now, before we got going on the treatment itself, we did a whole campaign of imaging and analysis, and that gave a major and unexpected discovery done by my colleagues Luke Sison and Rachel Billinge. And that was the fact that there was a completely different composition, one with very strong associations with other drawings and paintings from the early 1490s beneath. And that was really very extraordinary. You can't really see so well from the infrared on the left, but the red diagram shows you what we were able to parse from that. And here's another example. So we had a sort of almost a nunciate-style Virgin, but she's adoring her child, reaching like this. And you can see it has strong links to some drawings, very small drawings that hadn't been linked to paintings before. And as we did more study and thought about this, you can just about see her face above the Virgin's head as it is now, and then it traced and copied on a bit of the Last Supper flipped around. So again, it has resonance with things happening in the 1490s, and that was a really fascinating discovery that we would never have, you can't see it from the surface, but it places the panel in a certain time and really enriched the discussion about its relationship with the one painted in the Louvre and the long genesis of the composition and all sorts of things. The use, recycling, and rescaling of cartoons. It told us a lot about his workshop and talked us, you know, through the key question in this case about nature and degree of collaboration involved in making a painting like The Virgin of the Rocks. And that's a collaboration which is in the painting's initial contract and is in fact a fundamental critical issue in thinking about how he worked in Milan. So all this kind of scientific and art historical research undertaken by colleagues across the gallery, here's some of Team Leonardo, gave us material for all sorts of formal and informal collaborative links between several gallery departments and their counterparts abroad, including the Brera, the Opificio della Pietradure, and the Louvre, and the results of which, of course, were disseminated in all sorts of conference papers, articles, the catalogue of the gallery's exhibition. But the point for tonight is that while the scope of the Leonardo activity is bigger than usual, the model of working in research is quite typical of what we aim to do. And that's something you can see very easily by going back to the exciting technical bulletin. In fact, it is. In fact, the Leonardo restoration is simply a more recent example of that pattern of interdisciplinary work that was implicit in those 1947 Weaver Report recommendations. So, you know, that means that the group of gallery paintings identified as priorities for conservation, you know, we expected to provide a similar hub for research activities. And I'll just give you, run through a couple of quicker examples. Recent work on two paintings by Verrocchio, this Virgin and Child with Two Angels. It gave the chance to think about the question of workshop delegation and attribution there. Without going into too much detail, the execution and perhaps the design of the right angel, the Christ child, and the curtains was newly given to one of his associates, Lorenzo Di Credi. And this work as well, another Virgin and Child with Two Angels, is now a new attribution to the young Verrocchio, and it's given new insight into his development as a painter at a time of rapid change in techniques and materials, for example, moving from tempera to oil paint. And both of these were written at length on the gallery's website and within the Bulletin. Excuse me. And while it's fair to say that, generally speaking, we think about a major restoration like Frederick Rehel on Horseback, the Rembrandt, it starts with a wish to make the picture look better, and then we study it and learn all sorts of interesting things, new ways of thinking about the painting. In this case, however, the decision to do the treatment came after my curatorial colleagues and scientific colleagues had done a lot of technical and art historical investigation going back some years before, and that helped unlock some of the apparent problems about the picture and gave us more confidence in contemplating actually doing the treatment. So the painting's curator, Betsy Wiesman, came to study the painting while she was thinking about the Rembrandt exhibition we had at the gallery a few years ago. And the results of that study are, again, in the Bulletin. And I'll show you here, for the first time we did a digital assembly of the complete x-ray. In the 1959, when the picture was acquired, we only did a few limited plates, but this is the first time we put it all together. And then, you know, we learned that if you turn the x-ray 90 degrees, there's another painting underneath with a figure standing off center in this large, ambitious landscape. And this x-ray, to show such an image, tells you that this painting was taken quite far, if not complete, but definitely not finished. So, example, if you look at a comparison of the head of the finished painting and the head of the abandoned composition, you can see that the first image, the one on your left, has been blocked in but not really completely built up. And this leaves open this, you know, tantalizing question is whether this was also the same sitter. You know, kind of, did he decide, oh, I want to be on horseback, I don't like this image, did they discuss this? Was it completely recycled from another purpose? And so in this case, research done before the treatment, particularly the technical aspects, gave us a much clearer idea of how the painting came to look the way it did, giving a better sense of how it might be made more legible through conservation treatment. And so these discussions and exchanges between curators, scientists, and conservators were the essential background for the decision to do it in the first place, to do the treatment. So the cleaning, of course, improved the legibility, go on about saturation of the darks, etc., but also color relationships and spatial depiction, despite the fact that this particular painting was rather badly damaged in parts from early restorations and irreversible pigment changes. And so I think the restoration challenge was to restore the painting's legibility, yet making sure we respected those inherent changes in condition. So this is one of these things where you think about judging the level of finish of a restoration, and that's another kind of area in which those ongoing collaborative discussions and investigation, both of the hard scientific fact and then the aesthetic implications between scientists and curators and restorers, is essential. Just as a postscript, we got some new imaging technology, an X-ray fluorescence scanner on loan from Delft University. We're going to be acquiring it quite soon ourselves after the treatment, and we had a bit of a go. I won't go into the details. Let's pretend I understand them. but you can see it's given a much clearer example. The X-ray fluorescence scanner allows you to focus and make maps of particular chemical elements that in many cases are strongly associated with individual pigments, although not always. So you can start to get a sense of different pigments. And anyway, it became very clear as we looked at these things that this kind of blobby shape to the right of the figure, it was actually quite a friendly standing hunting dog. You can see that shape to the right move back and forth. But that was a mystery before, and that was quite nice to see. And indicative of the new advances in imaging and lots of, I think, exciting discoveries around the corner in this area. So just giving a wider view of what we get up to, I should point out that we also use part of our resources to helping other public institutions that don't have conservation resource or expertise. And here you see a painting of Joachim Utwal's Raising of Lazarus, which came from a county council museum in High Wycombe. It had never been on display because it used to look like you see on the left. And now art historical research has established that this is the first principal version of a composition he repeated a great deal. And you can follow this restoration on a short film available through the gallery's website. So I think it's fair to say that the department has got a considerable range now of responsibilities and skills. It has rare expertise in structural treatment of panel and canvas supports, cleaning and retouching, and knowledge of techniques and materials within that wider context of established collaborative research. Its members are frequently included in international commissions overseeing other treatments elsewhere. Gallery conservators have been involved in such groups advising on treatments of these works you see here. And we also have a significant role now in teaching and mentoring within our profession, whether through our recently endowed fellowship position or as advisors and examiners at several postgraduate teaching programs. In future, the core emphasis of the department will remain on its practical work, where it must keep abreast of new techniques and materials. Excuse me. The existing gallery model of collaborative effort and research also extends into the more practical aspects of conservation treatments, especially in the arena of craft skills that are fundamental to best conservation practice. Now, I'll just briefly touch on something called the Getty Conservation Institute's Panel Paintings Initiative. That was a program to give amazing opportunities for younger or mid-career conservators to develop their panel conservation skills for more experienced colleagues. The gallery participated by sending one of its conservators to work on a major project run by the Open Feature della Pietra Dura in Florence, which has in turn enabled the successful execution of some very highly complex treatments, such as this work done on our altarpiece by Giovanni Martini da Udine. Now, here you can see a very typical, it's a big panel, it's a couple of meters tall at least, with a 19th century structure added to the back of the thin panel that caused all this cracking and splitting. So the treatment consists of taking that structure off the back, joining the panels, replacing wood where necessary, and then creating a very extraordinarily engineered, lightweight structure, which is only attached in tiny points and gives enough support and flexibility for the thinned, repaired panel to be able to respond to changes in environment. And this is a treatment led by my colleague, Britton New, who was the restorer who went and participated in the gallery, the Getty program. And I think the department also, as I mentioned before, has established a program of postgraduate fellowship in practice of paintings conservation. It's something called the Patrick Lindsay Conservation Fellow, endowed from Patrick's estate. The position was intended by him to honor the training he got in the 1940s at the National Gallery from Helmut Ruhrmann, and to provide an ongoing context for today's emerging restorer to get a similar sort of experience working on practical skills in the professional setting of best museum practice. And this, I think, is hugely important for the future of the practice of restoration. I think today's mechanisms of funding and dissemination of research, that they struggle a bit with measuring craft skills. Institutional working life can sometimes find it easier to think about publications than, you know, respecting the ability to make and judge the appropriate gloss of a varnish, for example, or what the right amount of retouching is necessary. So the modern museum context, I think, is the really marvelous opportunity for a restorer to work, where you have complementary skills of conservator, scientist, and curator coming together for mutual benefit. But that balance is fine and is evolving and always up for discussion. And I think it's also highly desirable that a gallery or any museum gets the benefit of conservators having continuity and perspective afforded by long-term engagement with the collection. An in-house conservation is essential for mentoring of younger colleagues in both the skills of the profession and the needs of the gallery. If you're wondering what these slides are, the chap on the left of the left-hand photograph, my predecessor Martin Wild, is the man on the left on the right-hand photograph. So that's, you know, his span of working life at the National Gallery. So the collective memory of a museum department allows nuanced judgments about preservation and treatment of each work. And that gives us, it's based on a fuller awareness on all kinds of issues, environmental response, loan history, treatment history, behavior of works that are close to it. And then by association, that gives us a very good understanding of long-term performance of our own conservation materials and treatments. In-house conservators have an important influence across the whole of the gallery through their continuous professional interaction with their colleagues. The resulting heightened institutional awareness of the painting as a physical object is a really important element of wider discussions about environment, aesthetics of display, possibilities of loan, public interpretation, or even the aims and objects of gallery research. I think it's vital to the institution, whatever changes it may face, and we're in a very changing landscape like most public sector museums. So the circumstances of the gallery's foundation, you know, created by an act of parliament as a public gallery and not coming from an aristocratic collection, has led to a high sense of public ownership. This in turn has helped give a very healthy and sometimes heated debate about many of its practices, as we've seen, including conservation. This has occasionally been rather difficult, but on balance, it's been a very positive process. And so the evolution of the role of conservator has been considerable, but I think considered, much as the restoration work of the gallery's first keeper was described in his obituary, good old William Sager. It said, where little was required, little was done, but that little judiciously. Now, I wrote that last line was going to be my ending, but then I thought about what it might mean to say that here, and I wasn't so certain about it, the little part, I mean. And I wonder if the level of intervention I've been describing seems as minimal to you as it does to me. I mean, there's no denying that any kind of treatment or intervention has an elective, you know, an editorial or interpretive element, even if the broad intention is always to be minimal or neutral or objective. In the kind of Western painting I've been describing, there's a very curious and, I think, variable tension between the living work of art and the thing itself, the antique object. And even within that category, we have a kind of sliding scale between how we think about the physicality of a 14th century panel or, say, an early 20th century work by Picasso. And the way we think about the properties of paint and whether they actually carry the expressive qualities of the work, to what degree that's intentional, all those things, they have such huge implications for the significance of any subsequent treatment. I mean, I like to think the best restorations are the ones you don't notice, but how that works in practice can be a pretty complicated business, and it's one that I think remains open for discussion. Thank you very much.
Larry has kindly agreed to take some questions, so if there are any questions. Well, perhaps I can start the ball going. A very ignorant question. You said there was noise, that if you had parties, that would you also do studies on that. How would noise affect paintings?
Oh, we were concerned there about resonant frequencies and decibels, you know, amplified music, say. Mm-hmm. So if you have... It's about shock and vibration.
Right.
The same. It's a more small scale example of the thing you might think about during building work. You know, a jackhammer. What does that mean about transmission of vibration along the wall if you're digging out the basement? So you'd be surprised how loud music can be.
Parties at the National Gallery. We have a question over there.
When an art historian asked about if you have a special period or a special time, generally we're speaking about Renaissance or medieval or something like that. But I'm wondering if you have a special time of restoration that you're a specialist in, That is to say, do you work specially with the restoration practices that happened in the 1940s? Or do you have an area, are you just a general? Or what do you, what,
well, I well, think the profession broadly breaks down into kind of material classes. There's wall paintings, works on paper. We're considered easel painting restorers, which basically means not fresco, not paper. Mm. And within that sort of old master kind of classical techniques. Mm-hmm. So, I mean, I think everyone in the gallery and the conservation department should be competent to work on a basic kind of treatment of anything from the 13th to the late 19th century. Within that, of course, we develop different areas of research interest and greater awareness and expertise, structural treatment versus retouching. But, you know, we're broadly speaking within that fairly narrow category. We're generalists, you know, with certain specializations.
Do you have a particular specialization? I mean, if you dared, I mean, you have a broad range, but do you personally have a specialization?
I probably know a little bit more about 16th and 17th century than other things, but I think one of the pleasures about doing this job over time is in terms of preferences, your taste broadens all the time because you're exposed to works that you know you may not have been as aware of, and you learn about them and sort of immerse yourself, and it's quite exciting, I think, and one of the more rewarding parts of it.
I have a question over there. I'm curious to know the type of paint that you use, because surely if you restore an old master, the type of the brand or the type of colors, the ink that they use then of the paint is different from the ones you use now, or does it matter?
Oh, no, that's a good question. I didn't want to go too much in the techniques or the technical areas, but it's certainly true that, you know, we try to do retouchings of most losses that you can't see in the gallery. We want them to be deceptive. But we don't do that by using the same materials. What we try and do, we always do, we use stable equivalent pigments. Some of them are the same, like ochres, iron oxides, but say transparent colors will be quite different. And we use very, very different media. We don't use oil paint. We use synthetic resins that have a long working life and properties are quite well known. And we work always on top of our varnish. So both the resin itself is soluble and the varnish on which it sits is removable. But what we always try to replicate is the layer structure, the stratigraphy, and that's the key. And in that way, we're very faithful to the old master paintings. If you get an effect, if the artist got an effect, say, by putting a very transparent dark red on top of, say, an opaque orange to get a rich shadow, there's no way we can do that without doing something quite similar. And so in that way, we absolutely follow the techniques, but we don't use the same materials. Because oil paint, for example, darkens and becomes more transparent quite a lot in the first century, and then that change slows down. So if you match aged oil paint with new oil paint and make perfect restorations, you find that your retouchings darken while the painting stays the same. And that's what we're often dealing with, the consequences of discolored 19th century oil paint restorations, for example.
Any other questions?
Is there anything that you could call a stylistic controversy about how you restore? You know, are there institutions who take a radically different approach to yours, or is there a sort of scientific consensus about it, or?
No. there is a scientific, you know, certain fact, and I think, but I'd like everyone to understand that objective science provides criteria for decision making, but we are, it's highly subjective element, and there's always the idea of a period I, and we think we don't have it, but of course we do. And I think the differences have diminished, broadly speaking, in Western European museums as communication has been enhanced and study and travel and images exchanged. And there are many more few, there used to be sort of national schools of restoration. And a lot of them boil down, you know, there are variations on the discussions I showed you from the 1850s, that a discolored varnish gives a lovely unity. A clean picture allows you to understand parts unchanged and other parts changed. So what's the trade-off, for example? No, people do, but that's why we try and reach a kind of consensus, and we do exchange views. And I think the only thing, the key mitigating factor in proposing the treatments that we do is that We document everything very, very effectively, and we use materials that are quite reversible. So, Ellen, you can't undo a cleaning. You certainly can undo a restoration. So, you know, 18 months of work on the Leonardo could be washed off in 15 minutes very, very easily with no risk to the picture. So from that point of view, that's how we try to respect those discussions. But no, I mean, restorers love monographic exhibitions because, you know, the Rembrandt from here looks different than the Rembrandt from there, and then from there and has a different history. Maybe this one's been restored 12 times, this one hasn't been touched, this one's, you know, you're always looking. You know, a picture on the wall of a museum is not a received tablet that came down from the mountain. It has a history and a whole series of choices and decisions behind it, and how it looked the way it did and how it looks the way it does.
There's one at the back. Okay.
Mm-hmm. And he also had some criticisms of the National Gallery restoration. I think along the same lines that, you know, the emphasis was on bringing out the color. I just wonder if you are aware of those criticisms. This is about 1970s or 1980s?
Well, yeah, I mean, it's again, it's a trope, actually. It's the same story that I showed you, and, you know, more nuanced, of course, about, you know, how you evaluate the benefits of removing discolored varnishes, where individual parts of a painting have aged differently. And what that consequence is. So, of course, I'm aware of all those discussions. I would say one thing that has emerged in the last few years, at least where we work, the things I have control over, is that there is no sense of a house style anymore. And I hope I showed you this evening that there, I showed you pictures relatively fully cleaned, partially cleaned, selectively cleaned, and not cleaned at all. And those are all in response not just to technical concerns, but also a kind of consensus of discussion about the aesthetic implications, you know, of what we've got up to. But yes, there are always going to be opposing views about this. And I think studying the history of conservation, if anything, you know, makes you aware that it's never going to stop. And nor should it.
Any other questions? Well, perhaps we can call this to an end, but before it ends, we always have to have a couple of things. First of all, can I invite Professor Derek Collins on stage to present a gift to our speaker tonight, Larry?
Oh. Can I also ask
Derek, if you don't mind staying on the stage, we're going to have a group photograph taken with some of our if you'd like to stand in the middle.
Okay.
Can I also invite Mary Louise Salberg, who will be giving a talk on Friday. So if you can make it, it's going to be Friday at Asia Society, and she's going to be talking about Westminster Abbey. Can I also invite our sponsors, Mr. Chan, Mr. Lam from Qatar Airways, from Axel Art, Mr. Kadeen Khan, and of course our head of department, Professor Clark.
Thank you for that.